Today I thought I'd do a video about a couple gouache paintings. After getting my Himimiya gouache, I found some more on sale and ordered them. I also got this tin from the dollar store, and this other heart tin from before, though I have to be careful not to drop this one. The other dollar store tin that comes with colored pencils is perfect. Some old dollar store watercolors that I scraped out of these old palettes, then I filled in watercolor and gouache. I use various palettes from the dollar store and around. Here I have made the color swatches that go with the different tins, so I know exactly what's in them in the correct order. Elsewhere I also have labeled versions of these palettes. I also have empty half pans. This is my new Monet tin, so I'm going to mix some new colors for it. It's not the easiest to open, but that's actually a good thing, so it will not accidentally open, and if you drop it goes upside down, the half pans fit so perfectly the paint doesn't get everywhere. I have these handmade sketchbooks made with different colors of cardstock. So on one of the pages in here, I'm going to do a painting. This first part here is a 15-minute art challenge. I've sped it up so that the whole video won't be just about this. I paint everything in here in the 15-minute time limit. However, I got all the paint out, open, ready to go, got the water ready, the book ready, and everything else out. I got my reference put up, and I had everything ready to go so that I wouldn't waste any time during the limited 15 minutes. I also paused the timer in order to allow for drying time and didn't include it. The 15 minute challenge was just the actual active painting time. I also actively look at my swatches and figure out what I'm going to do. Even though this is cheaper cardstock paper, by using makeup brushes and working wet and wet, through several techniques I've worked and learned over the years, I actually find it fairly easy to use even quite cheap papers or decent cardstock like this and get really interesting and good effects. I keep practicing and learning all the time. I'm planning this out carefully, knowing I have 15 minutes total affects how I'm working. I have to get layers done. I'm planning the underneath layer before the stuff that goes on top. This jellyfish actually has very solid colored stripes on top, so I have to get all the semi-transparent and transparent looking areas done first so I can put the stripes on top. There's a bit of drying time here where I go get a blow dryer that I don't count on the timer, but I could have done the whole thing in an honest half hour even without the hair dryer if I simply worked in the correct order because of how fast gouache actually dries. I already previously mixed up the shades of brown I was using for the stripes. In the heart-shaped tin I'd shown near the beginning of the video, I had mixed up different shades of this beautiful brown color, which very closely matches the reference photo. In this case, I'm more or less copying a reference photo while changing a few details, which is a public domain image I got a while back. Because I'm rushing, the bottom of my hand got a little wet and actually got the paper wet in another spot, but luckily there is no paint down there. If you're trying not to get hand oils on the paper, or you're trying not to smudge or damage work underneath, be more careful about this and consider putting a paper underneath to catch underneath your hand. But in this case, it was all about speed and just the final touches here. And now, here's one final look at the finished and dried painting. I actually think it turned out really good for a 15-minute challenge. Let me know what you think in the comment section below. And now the next art, a Styracosaurus. This Styracosaurus was previously sketched out on a random line sheet of paper, because of course I'd done a really good pose I liked in a random ballpoint pen on a random line sheet of paper as a doodle. I gathered and printed out very good Styracosaur reference and did several studies elsewhere first. Then I did this quick doodle and realized I loved it. So what I did is I upscaled and printed it back out, darkening the line art and printing it in black and white on my printer. Once I got it to this size you see here, I worked it out on just random paper to correct any anatomical mistakes by referencing the actual Styracosaur art. From there, I did transfer methods in order to get it in the final place on this paper. I used dark colored graphite and did both sides of a tracing paper in order to get it transferred onto the sheet. It didn't come out very clear, so I went over it both in light graphite and in white cold erase pencil, so you can faintly see these lines on the page here. I could see it a bit better in real life than it comes out on camera, but it wouldn't actually show up much in the final artwork, which is ideal. mixing the colors ahead of time, as well as mixing on the palette as I went along, using a limited color palette. I looked at several real animals as well for reference and worked out the kind of habitat I was thinking Styracosaur tended to live in. This Styracosaur artwork is actually for a fantasy book, my Great Tree book, which is just a working title, that I'm working on as a 5e compatible book I'm going to release myself. I've already showed several artworks I've been working on for this book. Styracosaurus is a dinosaur not present in any official 5e D&D books, and it's a dinosaur I really like. I definitely want to include enough paleontological creatures in here, and I think it's a good mid-sized to fairly large still ceratopsian that would be fun to have included in the game, and it would be a good option to have as a mount. I think it would also be good for polymorphing and wild shaping for druids. But I, in general, didn't want all the artwork to just be digital. I'm really enjoying working in gouache, and I think I've gotten quite good at it, so I decided I'm going to do some of the illustrations for the book traditionally in gouache on paper. I might use other mixed media art as well. One of the benefits of gouache is because it's so matte and beautiful, it's easy to scan and photograph, and therefore it'll look very true to its original colors if I just scan this artwork to use for the Great Tree book itself, or photograph it using the camera on the iPad. Styracosaurus had 6 particularly large horns on its frill that projected upwards, though there was some variation between individual skulls found. A centrosaurian ceratopsian, it had 1 large central nose horn, and in the case of Styracosaurus, was particularly large in the horn area and particularly stunning to look at. On multiple occasions, the bones of several different individual Styracosaurs were found together, and all the evidence points to them being herd living animals. They were herbivores that used that beak and a battery of grinding teeth in their jaws in order to eat plant material. With a total body length of 18 feet, 5.5 meters, and a skull length of 6 feet, 1.8 meters, it had a very large head proportionately. On Earth, they're from Late Cretaceous, North America, and have been discovered multiple times in multiple locations. They're considered a centrosaurian, ceratopsian, and are closely related to Centrosaurus, although they have even more interesting frill in my opinion, and I suppose lots of people's. Still being a very large animal, they were not as large as Triceratops was. The largest ceratopsians grew larger than Styracosaurus. That's part of the reason why I did want to include it in the book I'm working on, because I wanted it to be a slightly smaller one, but still in the huge size category. Here I'm adding lots of the highlight, and I'm implying scales. Another thing to remember about Styracosaurus is that it had fairly short tails proportionately. Even though in general ceratopsians didn't have long tails, Styracosaurus had fairly short tails. There's lots of different ways I could color this animal, but I decided to go with more of a camouflaged cream brown coloration, but I wanted it to look interesting as well. And when you imagine Styracosaurus on your own fantasy world, if you want to put them on a fantasy world, if you're thinking into the past on Earth, or if you're just playing on an existing fantasy world but adding them into your Dungeons & Dragons or other tabletop role-playing game, you can imagine what colorations you would prefer. I'm thinking that they probably would have some form of camouflage to blend in a little bit, but it's not clear exactly at this point, though I'm going more with the coloration that would go with the ceratopsian we know the colors of better to an extent, which is Psittacosaurus. An extremely well-preserved fossil of a Psittacosaur, considered a dinosaur mummy, has skin impressions that are so detailed they include even color and pattern information. But I did go a different way, so I didn't exactly just copy Psittacosaur. Each individual ceratopsian would certainly have its own coloration, as relatives that are close in terms of body structure can have very different colors in the real world in the modern day. And the other thing to remember is what ecological niche it fills. So, stripes. I decided, first of all, stripes are cool. Second of all, zebras have them and other animals. And I decided, you know, I'm going to go with what feels cool and plausible. So I mixed cool and plausible. The point is, this creature is actually for use in fantasy games, so it should definitely be cool and something people would want to include. Of course, Styracosaurs are always cool. But also, I wanted to keep this paleoart somewhat accurate. I didn't want it to be a complete fantasy version of the animal. I also wanted it to be more of a plausible fantasy art. Another thing to note is the eyebrow horns are actually apparently recessive in full-grown adults, and they're only present in juveniles and younger ones. And I also went with a sort of just eyebrow ridge horn configuration, which isn't, I don't know if it's the most scientifically accurate, but as I said, this is a fantasy version of a styracosaur for a fantasy book, so I don't feel it has to be the most accurate paleoart in the history of paleoart at the same time. So I hope I'm not offending any paleontologists, because I certainly enjoy paleontological study and want to include that in here. But the primary focus of this art is more as a cool creature for fantasy games, for tabletop role-playing, as something people can use as a mount, and as something players can transform into, so it has to fill those roles. So when you're layering gouache, you have to be careful not to activate the colors underneath. I found I've gotten actually very good at this, and I find I have no trouble with it at all. It also depends on the type of paper you're working on. Remember that each surface and paper you work on will behave a bit differently. But gouache can work on all kinds of different papers, and I personally love to use it on colored paper, even very thin colored paper. Now, if the paper you have warps easily with a lot of water and can't handle a lot of water, you have to use the gouache thicker on that paper more. And you have to be very gentle not to reactivate the layers underneath. The thicker the paint is, the less water in it, the easier it is to lay it down without activating the colors underneath, but also how gentle you are and the way you stroke the paint on it. A lot of this does come with practice and experimentation. The other thing to remember is that if you don't put enough water, it'll end up getting a sort of dry brush effect. So I do advise putting a little bit of water, but honestly, if you can get the different textures and consistencies to be able to flow but also still be very thick, that's better for not activating things underneath and better for working on paper that's not as suitable for wet. So for thin paper or regular cardstock, I recommend working thicker with gouache. I like working thicker with gouache personally. But the other thing is you can mix watercolor and gouache, you can use colored pencil on top, you can do a lot of stuff, and I do recommend experimenting and doing additional research if you're trying to work with gouache. I find it to be a versatile and amazing medium, and the jelly gouache has become my favorite paint. I hope you enjoy this final look at the styracosaur. Once again, that's all for this video. If you like my videos, please remember to like, subscribe, and turn on that notification bell to all notifications so you will know when a new video comes up. I aim for new videos every Wednesday, but sometimes life happens and things are delayed. I hope that you enjoyed this video, and we'll see you with another one very soon.